sign of gratitude to the monks here who make all of this possible, and also something of a humble imitation of the great work that they do day in and day out in this basilica, especially concerning the Psalter, which is the great songs of the church. So all of these pieces are marked by a very dominant lyrical melody and then accompanied with the other hands. Some with words, some without words. And in the case of all three of these, they follow very much in the wake of Beethoven, who sort of brought the classical era to an end and began the Romantic period. And so they move in chronological order. And so Schubert, this first piece, Schubert wrote eight of these in two different sets. And this first one, in G flat, it's a very rare, very, very rare key. It's so rare, in fact, that the publisher, when it was first printed, didn't believe that the G flat key that Schubert originally wrote this for was what he intended to put in G major. For 30 years, the piece was performed in the incorrect key until they discovered this and made the correction. For those who are musicians and know this, this is it's a very, very rare key. Every note in the scale is flattened except for one, the F. So it's sort of particularly unique that way. It's also one of the most beautiful lyrical pieces that Schubert Thank you. This next piece by Mendelssohn, so we're moving on just a few years. And this next series, so Mendelssohn, Schumann, Robert Schumann, his wife Clara, and Franz Liszt are all in a kind of the same musical circle, you might say, in Germany, for Vienna. And this is the first of what is known as a Songs Without Words. So Mendelssohn wrote six sets of these across his life. And, you know, they quite intentionally are meant to just sort of be very lyrical pieces, very much suggestive of the song, but without words. And his sister, Fanny, also participated in writing some of these. And so now, some of them have, you know, greater or lesser musical depth. They haven't always been performed very, very often. It's sort of rare to hear them these days. But in any case, this first one, this is the very first of the first set in E major, and as you will see, you know, it closely imitates what we just heard with Schubert. Thank you. save the best for last. Require something of a little bit of a explanation. So, in its original form, Robert Schumann wrote the music to the poem, which he gave to his wife on their wedding day as a present. Hence the name "Dedication," Widmung in German. In the facing inside page here, you can see the text taken from the poem from your book, and an English translation below. List was one of these phenomenal transcribers, so somebody who can take any musical piece in any given form or setting and turn it into a piano piece or whatever it is he wishes to do. And in this case, he was certainly without equal in terms of the greatest piano transcriber. As a matter of fact, all of the other composers on this program, at least in my half, had their pieces turned into solo piano showpieces by Franz Liszt. Schubert's songs, Schumann's songs, even Mendelssohn's songs without words, believe it or not, were turned into unbelievable pyrotechnic showpieces by Franz Liszt, because he could do that. And so in this case, we've actually tried something very creative here with this performance, because typically when it's performed in Schumann's original intention, it would have just your sort of standard piano accompaniment, which he wrote for the solo soprano, who would sing the text of the poem. When Liszt got his hands on it, Liszt and not the sort of person who would readily share the concert stage with anyone else, turned the piece into a solo piece all the way. So he had his own accompaniment with the melodic line. So he brought the whole thing in without, so I don't need the singer. No. But Lily and I have decided to dispense with the traditional way in which you would typically perform this piece, which is to use Schumann's accompaniment. And instead, we are going to perform the solo line that Schumann wrote on top of the solo piano version of Franz Liszt, which results in something rather unique and perhaps something even unforeseen by both Schumann and Liszt respectively, because as it turns out, the way that Liszt wrote the piece, the way it comes out, seems very much to have in mind the setting in which the poem is written. So, for instance, the text of the poem is given the soprano line, which Schumann wrote for the female voice. However, between the stanzas, Franz Liszt adds the tenor line, which serves as a beautiful male counterpoint to the female line. So very much what comes out is something close to sort of a musical imagining of this conversation between Clara and Robert, where the tenor line is voiced by the piano alone, sort of being in the voice of Robert, the male tenor, and Lily taking what would be Clara's line, the text itself. Hope you enjoy this.
Thank you. So many pieces that we play as musicians are like stylized, but this one's actually published music that is danceful. And Nemanowski ended his career at the Curtis Institute of Music in Philadelphia. So he was also the founding conductor of the Warsaw Orchestra, so pretty exciting. A dance there. And next we're going to go to a meditation from an opera. This is from the next piece from the opera.